great honor to be with you this morning. I'm going to talk about creation, evolution, and deception. I really get annoyed when I'm deceived. I really get annoyed when people deceive me. I'm sure you do as well. And I want to show you this morning that many evolutionists deceive us. And they expect us to believe the nonsense they propagate. And I want to show you some of the implications of that deception. And I want to center it, first of all, around this verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. But I fear lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. And I first of all want to ask this question: what happened to the dinosaurs? I'm going to shock you, because what I want to do is to go through the last 40 years or so and tell you what the evolutionists have been telling us what happened to the dinosaurs. This is taken from a cartoon, from a book, which was published in 1992. And I think there's quite a few humorous things in this particular cartoon. But really what I want to do is to ask this question: according to the evolutionists, what happened to the dinosaurs? Well, as Ken has told you, I studied chemistry at the University College of Wales, Aberystwyth. Aberystwyth, in case you don't know, is a beautiful seaside place, and it's that's how you spell it, and it's on the west coast of Wales. That is where I was converted, that's where I got my degrees, and it's also where I studied geology. And in 1964-65, in my first year of studying geology at that university, this is what we were told happened to the dinosaurs. We were told that they died of constipation. And we were given lectures, and it was explained to us what type of plants they ate. How on earth they knew, I don't know, because they weren't there. And they told us what oils were in those plants. How they could tell you that, I don't know, because they weren't there. And we were told confidently that they died of constipation, and this is the type of thing that I had to, dare I use the word, regurgitate in order to pass my examinations at the end of that year. 10 years later, we were told that dinosaurs died of air pollution. Well, where did this air pollution come from? Well, they suffered from indigestion. And when they passed gas, there was a lot of methane in the atmosphere, and this caused the atmosphere to be polluted, and they died of air pollution. I don't know why you're laughing. This was the modern scientific theory at the time. This was taken as truth. It was taught in universities, certainly in the UK, and you saw it in journals and so on, and everybody believed it. And then what happened? Well, we were told in the 1980s that sunburn killed the dinosaurs. The dinosaurs were wiped out by lethal sunburn, according to British scientists. It goes on here, the ozone layer was destroyed and the earth was bathed in deadly ultraviolet radiation, and this caused the dinosaurs to die of sunburn. I've even got a photograph of the problems that they had for you. Well, which is the latest theory? This is what we want to know. What is the latest theory? Well, let's have a look at what Scientific American, an article that was published in December 2003. Less than 2 years ago, we were told by now it is common knowledge that the impact of an asteroid or comet brought the age of the dinosaurs to an abrupt end. Got a photograph of that as well. The question I want to ask is, really? Because within a couple of months, we were being told that the dinosaur death theory was just a myth. It's nice to hear the word myth and evolution used in the same sentence, isn't it, by the evolutionists. And we were told that it was wiped out, that the dinosaurs were wiped out by a series of comets hitting the Earth. And here we are. And then, a few months later, we were told this. According to scientists from Kiel University in Germany, dinosaurs were destroyed by a huge underground gas explosion which spewed poisonous fumes into the atmosphere, causing the Earth to be covered by a toxic cloud for decades. That was reported in New Scientist on the 6th of May 2004. Some scientists maintain that they haven't become extinct at all, they just evolved into birds. And just to prove this, this is taken from an article entitled Tyrannosaurus Wren. This is Dr. Dr. Mark Norell, who's chairman of the Division of Paleontology and curator of the Dinosaurs, Ancient Fossils, New Discoveries exhibit at the American Museum of Natural History in New York, which is being, you can go and see this currently. I would consider that living birds are not only derived from dinosaurs, they are dinosaurs. And if you look at one of the, in the guide to this exhibition, you read that some dinosaurs were feathered, not all dinosaurs were extinct. Birds, in fact, are dinosaurs. So, according to the evolutionists, what happened to the dinosaurs? Well, as you can see, they died out because of constipation, because of air pollution, because of sunburn, because of asteroid comet impact, because of a series of comet impacts, because of an underground gas explosion. Oh, they haven't become extinct at all. They've just evolved into birds. And so I would say to you that you can answer this question. It's written and then rewritten and rewritten and rewritten and rewritten. And my friends, if you invite me back when I'm a very old man in 20 years' time, and you ask me what is the latest theory, I'll guarantee there'll be something else. And so it will go on. You see, what we have to do is to get back to the Word of God. You know, Ken said right at the very beginning of this conference that we need to, you know, take back the dinosaurs. We need to get back to the Word of God where we read, it is written. Not it's rewritten and rewritten and rewritten and rewritten and rewritten, but it is written. You see, Psalm 118 verse 8 says, it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. And yet so many people today, they reject the Lord, they reject the written word of the Lord, and they put confidence in these men who are changing their mind every decade. They can't make up their mind what's happened to dinosaurs. In fact, they can't make up their mind what happened in the past, and the reason is they weren't there. Whereas the Lord was there, and he's revealed to us what happened in the past through his word. Well, what about this idea of dinosaurs to birds? I love this one. And we can make some wonderful cartoons about this, can't we? Of how dinosaurs evolved into birds. But what we need to do is look a bit more seriously at this. And look at the origin of feathers. I'm grateful to Dr. David Menton, for one or two of the illustrations I'm going to show now. But as you may or may not know, and if you've been to his lectures, you would know that a scale is just a fold of skin. And we have to find out how you can go from a fold of skin to the delicate feather. We read in an article about the theory of the origin of feathers in American zoology in the year 2000. And this is incredible, isn't it? We lack completely fossils of all the intermediate stages between reptilian scales and the most primitive feather. Ken has said about how the work in the United Kingdom has grown. I was invited to speak to a group of scientists at the Academy of Sciences of the Czech Republic. I often thought, you know, when I did research in chemistry and when I was a senior administrator at the University of Cardiff, I was never invited to speak to such an august body. I joined Answers in Genesis, and within 2 years I'm up there before the great and the good, in terms of brains, in the Czech Republic. And I gave them a talk. First of all, I castigated them for the fact that every single person there said they didn't believe the Bible, and they all admitted they'd never even read the Bible, and they'd not even opened the Bible, they'd not even read one verse of the Bible. And I said, how on earth can you reject something you don't know anything about? I then said to them, if I came here and started to talk about evolution, and I said to you, I'm sorry, I've never read a book about evolution, but I don't believe it, I said you would throw me out. So I challenged them to read the Bible, because that's what happened to me, you know. That's how I became a Christian. I was challenged to read the Bible. I was challenged to study the Bible, and I did so. And after a few months, I came to the conclusion that you could trust the Bible. I came to the conclusion that Jesus was the Son of God. I came to the conclusion that there was a God. And then I went to church, and I got convicted of my sins. And I repented of my sins and became a Christian. I'd been brought up to be an atheist. And as you can tell, my parents failed miserably in that respect. And I thank the Lord for that. At this lecture, at the end, there were some questions. And this lecturer said to me, he was a professor, he said to me, but we know that dinosaurs have changed into birds. We've got a complete, you know, the whole fossil record. And I said, no, you haven't. And he said, oh, well, he said, everybody knows that dinosaurs have changed into birds. And I said, well, where do you get the new genetic information from? This was a professor of biology, and he turned around to me and he said, oh, don't ask me about questions like that. I don't know. So let's have a look at the anatomy of a feather. And it is incredibly complicated. I am particularly interested in the little hooks which you find at the end of the anterior barbules in this area. And I've done a calculation, and I've come to the conclusion that on a typical bird feather, there's something like about 1,600,000 hooklets. Where are these? Let's have a look. Well, there in the center, you can see the rachis, and coming out, you can see the barbs and the barbules coming off the barbs. And if you magnify that section, and you can see these little hooklets, which have got the right radius of curvature to go around this posterior barb, which is there. The fact that that little end of the hook there fits into the groove on the underside of this little barbule. And I just find this absolutely incredible. And yet, that we have problems here, because when you try to use this type of argument for design, and you say, look, you look at these feathers and you see this intricacy of the feathers, you see all this design, you ask, you know, a couple of questions, you say, where does all this genetic information come from? And they can't tell you. And then you say, but look at this design. And then you're told that you can't use design. And they will tell you that evolutionary theory, although it can make little small changes, they tell you, and in this quote I'm using, it says that you do not get any guidance for understanding the emergence of entirely new structures, including digits, limbs, eyes, and feathers. So how did feathers originate? I would say to you that feathers originated because they were created by Almighty God, as we read in Genesis chapter 1, verses 20 to 21. And yet you have quotes like this. Even if all the data points to an intelligent designer, such a hypothesis is excluded from science because it is not naturalistic. The problem is, this is from Kansas State's University immunologist Scott Ted. So the problem is that even if we've got all this evidence of design, the evolutionists say, no way. Well, we don't accept that. They've even got a word for something that looks as if it's been designed, and they claim that it hasn't. They use the word designoid. Talk about suppressing the truth. Talk about being willingly ignorant. Talk about saying, no, I can't see design. You know, they are blinding themselves. It is incredible, some of the things that these evolutionists say.